Hello everyone, I'm Stephen Chen, come from National Cheng Kung University. It is our pleasure to talk about the evolution of Linux I/O model, a path toward I/O Ring. In the first section, I will introduce different I/O model in Linux. As I/O model, we can roughly divide them into synchronous I/O and asynchronous I/O. More specifically, synchronous I/O include at least three kinds of model, which is blocking I/O, non-blocking I/O, and I/O multiplexing. The detail will be mentioned in the following pages. In blocking I/O model, after sending a system call read to the kernel, its execution blocked. The kernel initiate the I/O operation and wait for its completion. After the operation completed, either successfully or not, the kernel sends a signal back to the application that was still in the holding state. Until that time, it did not continue executing more instruction. When the application received the result from kernel, the execution continued further instruction. In non-blocking I/O model, system call return immediately if data is not available. Then user procedure keep polling or does something else until the data is available. Finally, if data is available, processor will trap into the kernel and execute corresponding system call handler, which copy the data from kernel to the user space. In this page, I will give a real-world example who use blocking I/O model. As shown in the code block, this is a code snippet of LWAN, which is a high-performance and scalable web server. It is designed and implemented in non-blocking I/O model. By using FCNTL in Linux, it can manipulate file descriptor. Files of LWAN are manipulated into non-blocking mode. In the main loop, LWAN try to read data from non-blocking file. No matter what is the reason that data is not ready, the control will return immediately and continue further instruction. Then LWAN will skip this iteration if data is not ready or return as E again. Remaining work are to find an opportunity to read the file again. I/O multiplexing is the capability to tell the kernel that we want to be notified if one or more I/O conditions are ready, like input is ready to be read or if descriptor is capable of taking more output. There are several system calls can achieve it, such as epoch wait and select. Both of them are able to monitor multiple file descriptors, waiting until one or more of the file descriptors become available for some class of I/O operation. The advantage of this mode is that we can wait for more than one descriptor to be ready. On the other hand, the disadvantage is that one I/O operation might take two system calls for epoch wait and read. As shown in the code snippet, it is a simplified structure of I/O multiplexing program. In the first, epoch wait for event on the epoch instance, which is referred to by the file descriptor epoch fd. The buffer pointed to by event is used to return information from the ready list about file descriptor in the interest list that have some event available. As the return value, if the call is successful, NFDS is the number of file descriptor ready for the request I/O. Then we walk through the epoch event structure, handle the request depending on the information on that structure. So what is asynchronous I/O model? Instead of waiting until the file is read and can be used in the application, the user issue read operation as an asynchronous I/O operation through a different system call. With asynchronous system call, the application still wait for the system call to return, but it will return back to the user immediately after the I/O operation was issued successfully. After the response of the kernel, the application continue with its execution of further instruction, which do not depend on the I/O operation. The I/O operation signal the kernel when it is done, and the kernel will notify the application that the operation was successful or failed. Now, the application can process the I/O data. This significantly improve hardware utilization, shorten the execution time of the application, and even allow for multiple system call in parallel. However, application adopt asynchronous I/O model has to take care of its asynchronous nature, and the last system call can return in a different order than they were issued. As shown in the code snippet, when asynchronous version system call read was issued, the control will return immediately from the kernel space. Program will continue the execution of the following instruction. There is a kernel thread is taking over the execution of the I/O operation. After completion of the I/O operation, kernel thread will signal user process. Then user can get the result of the I/O request. So what we face in the last decade, after 2005, the speed of CPU start to stagnate and the architect engineer begin to design computer architecture in different direction to catch up Moore's law. Rather than just blindly speeding up the CPU, they proposed multi-core architecture, trying to package multi-cores into a CPU, using paralleling technology to achieve acceleration. After adopting new architecture, the first question must be how to well use them. For example, how operating system can optimally interact with several cores, how single storage device satisfies so many cores, how to deal with contention issue between several cores. With current computer architecture, there is not only multi-core design, but also large NUMA system. This will again intensify the problem illustrated in the previous page. However, thanks to the effort of both kernel developer and manufacturer, kernel developer replaced the design of single queue with multi-queue. This reduced the contention while I/O requests were issuing simultaneously. It can also be said to indirectly increase the bandwidth. By using high-performance dynamic memory controller and the multi-queue memory technology, the bandwidth of the DRAM was increased. For SSD, NVMe create parallel low-latency data path to underlying media to provide substantially higher performance and lower latency. Because of improving the bandwidth, all of them offer the great energy to fulfill parallel I/O. However, the nature of synchronous I/O blocking might hamper the performance of parallel I/O, so asynchronous I/O might be more suitable for parallel I/O since the requests issued asynchronously can be interleaved or overlapped. Asynchronous I/O sounds great. Why don't we always use asynchronous I/O to design application? In fact, in addition to the advantage of asynchronous I/O, its disadvantage cannot be ignored. As the advantage, asynchronous I/O can improve hardware utilization since I/O requests are offloaded to kernel thread. The number of affinity of each thread can be decided depending on the hardware characteristic. Asynchronous I/O can shorten the CPU cycle in user level. Instead of blocking and waiting for completion of the I/O operation, the execution in the user can continue further instruction. Asynchronous I/O also provides the potential to handle I/O in parallel because application can issue new I/O operation even previous operations are not completed. Even with so many advantages, we cannot ignore its disadvantage. Since asynchronous I/O allows issue multiple I/O operations, there is no guarantee that completion is in order. This issue might be serious when operations are dependent. To avoid this kind of dependent issue, application must be redesigned. Apparently, this procedure is not trivial. Actually, asynchronous I/O is not an old idea. There already an AIO interface to use. The POSIX asynchronous I/O interface is a user-level implementation. It allows application to initiate one or more I/O operations that are performed asynchronously. Besides user-level implementation, Linux kernel support native asynchronous I/O interface after Linux 2.6. In this session, POSIX AIO will be covered. This interface is implemented in user-level and allows application to overlap more than one I/O operation that are performed asynchronously. Basically, functionality of asynchronous I/O can be normally divided into three categories. The first type is responsible for initialization and deallocating. The second category is responsible for submission, enqueuing I/O requests into kernel. The third category is responsible for checking the status of completed I/O requests. For POSIX AIO, it doesn't provide setup helper function. The user needs to maintain the AIO control block by themselves. As a submission helper function, it supports three type operation, including read, write, and fsync. After submission, user need to monitor the status of submitted request. AIO return can retrieve the return result from completed request. AIO error can obtain the result whether IO requests are still in progress. As shown in the figure, it is the big picture of POSIX AIO. When IO requests are triggered, they will be dispatched to the global request list, which is the linked list where the requests with the same file descriptor are grouped. Further, POSIX AIO maintains several worker threads to take care of submitting requests from application. When a working thread is idle, it will fetch the head of the run list and work on another request. On the other hand, if there are no idle workers, then POSIX AIO will spawn a new worker thread until reach the limitation. Generally speaking, the execution path of application using POSIX AIO is similar. In the first step, user need to allocate a synchronous IO control block, which will be used later. After allocation, then fill the detailed information of I/O requests into control block. For example, if operation read will be enqueued, user must provide its information before submitted. The information contain what is the target file, the file offset, the location of buffer, and the length will be transferred. After filling data into control block, user can submit the operation. After submission, user is responsible for checking the status of issue request. By AIOA, user can obtain the status of them. Procedure must block until the requests are completed. If Lizzo is returned, the request is completed, then user can obtain the result of completed request by AIO return. Besides busy waiting for status of request, POSI AIO also provide mechanism to notify the user by signal. After receive signal, signal handler defined by user is triggered. This page shows use case in real world. POSI AIO is used in Lighty, a low footprint single-threaded high-performance web server. Lighty apply POSI AIO as a new backend option. Using asynchronous IO, it allows Lighty to overlap file operation. It sends an IO request for the file and get notified when it is ready. With less waiting and blocking time, it can handle other requests instead. On the other side, it gives the kernel to reorder the file request as it wants to. Combining the above factor, we expect AIO backend can enhance the overall performance. The performance improvement are measured in two perspectives. Start from server side, we care about the hardware performance and its utilization. With better hardware utilization, it means we didn't waste the resource. Start from the client side, we care about whether clients are satisfied with the service. The throughput, how many clients we can service in 1 second, is a good measuring metric. The experiment chose HTTP load to run multiple HTTP fetches in parallel to test the throughput of a web server. The experiment set on 100 parallel connection and tried to fetch in 10,000 UI load. In the table, the result show the AIO send file give less IO waiting time, more blocks are read per second, better throughput and less time to complete 10,000 requests. In this section, Linux native AIO or KAIO will be covered. KAIO is included in Linux V2.6. It enables a single application thread to overlap IO operation with other processing by providing an interface for submitting one or more IO requests in one season call without waiting for completion, and a separate interface to read completed IO operation associated with a given completion group. libAIO provides the Linux native API for asynchronous IO. The first type is responsible for initialization and deallocating the IO context. The second type is responsible for submission in queuing IO requests into kernel. The third category is to wait for IO completion. For libAIO, provide only one function about submission. To execute different IO, OV code in control block must be set properly. After submission, user need to block and wait for completion by IO get event. Like POSI AIO, the execution flow of application using libAIO is similar. In the first step, user need to create a synchronous IO context and set the proper depth of the queue. Then user can fill the detailed information of IO request into IO control block. Those information contain what is the type of operation, target file descriptor, file offset, location of buffer, and the length will be transferred. After filling data into control block, user can submit the batched operation in one shot. After submission, user need to wait for completion. User can decide the minimum number of completed event need to wait. When the number of completed event reach minimum number of timeout expired by IO get events, then it return. After return, user can repeat the second step, submit another new IO request. If not, it is fine to tear down the IO context and leave the asynchronous call section. Although both POSI AIO and KAIO are implemented as asynchronous IO model, they are essentially different. In implementation, POSI AIO is implemented in user level that perform normally blocking IO in multiple threads, hence giving the illusion that the IO are asynchronous. However, KAIO is actually implemented in kernel level, where the IO requests are actually queued up in the kernel, sorted by whatever disk scheduler kernel have. For applicability, POSI AIO work on all file systems and all operating systems since GVBC is portable. On the other hand, KAIO only works on file open with flag all direct. Although the file are failed to open with all direct, it may still work, but it probably isn't done asynchronously, but it fall back to blocking semantic. In this section, the latest asynchronous IO interface, IO Urine, will be covered. It aims at providing API without the limitation of existing AIO interface. According to Jens Espo, the author of IO Urine, the design goals are listed in the list page, which is in roughly ascending order of importance. The first goal of IO Urine is easy to use and hard to misuse. The interface should be easy to understand and intuitive to use. This might be achieved by providing a user-level library, which can hide kernel detail from user. In this case, libUrine provides a simplified API and help user easier to use. The second goal is extendable. In the previous AIO interface, usage is limited. Operation on buffer file or socket will fall back to synchronous or blocking. IOurine tried to be useful for not only blocking-oriented IO, but also networking and non-blocking storage. The third goal is feature-rich. iodine is not designed for or only cover specific application. To do so, it can prevent from reinventing the same functionality over and over again. The fourth and fifth goal are efficiency and the scalability. Both of them are common goals of designing a new interface. We will explain later why iodine can be said to be an efficient and scalable interface. As shown in the figure, it is the big picture of iodine. There are two core components, submission queue and the completion queue, which also be called SQ and CQ respectively. For the submission queue, the application is the producer who submits the request to the queue, and the kernel is the consumer who takes the request from the queue. In the upside, for the completion queue, the kernel produces completion event and the application waits for them. To make the interface more efficient, iodine doesn't copy the data between kernel and the user. Instead, submission and the completion queue will share between kernel and the application. Both of them are implemented as a single producer and a single consumer ring buffer, which can satisfy the need of efficiency. It's kind of hard to directly use the same call of iodine provided. Libiodine provides a more high-level interface to iodine, make it far more productive. It also removing a lot of boilerplate code, making the program a lot shorter and to the point. As a typical iodine application, it must first provide the characteristic of the instance, such as the depth of the queue. After initialization, we expect to get an iodine instance. After initialization, then we can get the next available entry of submission queue by iodine get SQE, then called preparing function, which fills the type of operation and its parameter to the entry. After filling, using iodine submit to submit those batch requests. When tests are completed, they will be appended to the tail of completion queue, and the application is responsible for taking care of the completion event. They need to walk through all completion queue events and do error handling if needed. Basically, functionality of libiodine can be divided into three categories. The first type is responsible for initialization and deallocating. The second category is responsible for submission, including get the next available entry, preparing the parameter required for events and submitting all batched requests on the queue. The third category is responsible for reaping the completion event on completion queue, including walk through all completion event and retrieve next available completion event. Besides introducing the design of iodine and the usage of libiodine, we will also give one kind of design of libiodine application. We choose an echo server as an example. We will divide this example into three parts. In the first part, we explore how libiodine application do initializing routine. As shown in the code snippet, there is no difference between echo server and the libiodine echo server. We still need to create socket by function socket, bind this socket to an IP and port where it can listen in for the connection. The only difference is we need to create an iodine instance by API provided from libiodine. After initialization, the execution jump into the main loop. The main loop is designed as finite state machine. The initial state is a SIP, which is added outside the while loop. Entering while loop, it will first submit all batched requests on the submission queue. Then it walks through all events on completion queue. Depending on the type of the event, we can decide what is the next operation should be and add it as a new event to the submission queue. For example, in server perspective, if it's the previous season call is read, it must perform write operation because it needs to echo the content got from read. The finite state machine of echo server is depicted on the top right corner. Continuing from the previous page, server transits to next state depending on current state. The question is how can server know what is the type of current completion event? Actually, both submission and completion queue event provided a field user data. This field is carried from the initial request submission and can contain any information that the application needs to identify the request. The kernel will not touch this field. It is simply carried straight from submission to completion event. In this example, user data was pointed to REQ info. In the following three pages, they will cover three kinds of advanced usage of libiodine. The first usage is event ordering. Operation and submission queue are dependent, means the execution of one does affect the execution of subsequent SQE entry in the ring. This issue restricts the potential opportunity of completing requests in parallel for maximum efficiency and performance. In this page, we will give two scenarios whose operation and submission queue are dependent. The first scenario is that there is a season call, fsync, follow several writes. Actually, we don't care about the order of those writes. We only care about data synchronization executed when all the writes have completed. iodine provides flag iodrain, which makes the current event will not be started before previously submitted event have completed. The second scenario is stronger ordering. For example, if we would like to write something into file, we need to use system call open and write. However, write will only happen if open file is succeed. A log IO drain can fix this kind of dependency issue. IO drain support more granular event sequence control. Linked submission queue event provide a way to describe dependency between a sequence of submission queue events, where each event execution depends on the successful completion of the previous event. If IO link was set, the next event will not be started before the previous event has completed successfully. If the previous event doesn't fully complete, the chain is broken and the link event is cancelled. The second usage is submission queue polling. Despite IO urine is efficient in allowing more requests to be both issued and completed through fewer system calls, there are still cases to improve by further reducing the number of system calls. After enabling SQ poll, a kernel thread is created and start to poll whether there is ready event and submission queue. If true, thread submit those events from kernel. Polling feature actually eliminates the need to switch to the kernel when submission event. That is to say, polling can reduce the number of system calls even fewer. This is important especially after Spectre and Meltdown mitigation. As other optimization technique, IO urine allow to set affinity. Each thread can be bounded to specific CPU, which is expected to increase locality. Also, to avoid wasting too much CPU while the IO urine instance is inactive, the kernel size thread will automatically go to sleep when it has been idle for a while. The third usage is fixing file and buffer. Imagine a scenario where a file descriptor is filled into a SQE and submitted to the kernel. The kernel must retrieve a reference. Once IO has completed, the file reference is dropped again. The cost of this process is not cheap, but it's worth. This might happen again and over again. To alleviate this issue, IO urine provide a way to pre-register a file set for an IO urine instance. This is done by using register function with OP called IO urine register file. Besides fixed file, IO urine also offer a function to pre-register a set of fixed IO buffer. This can be achieved by registering instance with OP called IO urine register. This function is especially suitable for direct IO files because when direct IO files are used, the application page must be mapped to the kernel before it can be operated, and it needs to be unmapped after the operation completed. It is very time consuming. However, with fixed buffer, it only needs to be mapped and unmapped once. In this page, we will show some performance results done by author of IOURIN. We show the statistic measured in the 2019. The performance of IOURIN is measured by randomly reading from the block device or file. POSI AIO gets 608 kilo IOPS. IOURIN without polling gets 1.2 million IOPS, and IOURIN with polling gets 1.7 million IOPS. There is also statistic measured by FIO in October 2021. IOURIN with polling gets 10 million IOPS. In this page, we give another benchmarking result. The test used the well-known FIO utility to evaluate four different interfaces: synchronous read, POSI AIO, Linux AIO, and IOURIN. The test is conducted on NVMe storage that should be able to read at 3.5 million IOPS, using 8 CPUs to run 72 FIO jobs, each issuing random reads across 4 files with an IO depth of 8 and ran the test with the direct IO flag. As shown in the table, IOURIN outperforms other 3 interfaces. For POSI AIO, it is implemented in the user level, and there are many worker threads. It is expected that there are lots of context switches. This also explains why POSI AIO performs worst. In this test, all configurations are same except it uses buffer IO. It preloads the data into memory. As the same as previous testing, IOURIN performs better than other 3 interfaces. POSI AIO is still worse since there are lots of context switches. There are two interesting parts. The first thing is that libAIO will fall back to synchronous IO when operate on buffered IO, so we can find that the difference in performance between libAIO and IOURIN become larger. The second thing is the performance of synchronous IO get closer to IOURIN comparing with the test one. This might be IOURIN is more suitable on direct IO. IOURIN is still growing, and it is growing fast. Its IOPS nearly doubled in a 2-month period. Over the past decade, computer architecture design has started to focus on parallel architecture. Besides architecture design, also thanks for manufacturer and software engineers' effort. All of them provide great energy to drive the program model from synchronous one to asynchronous one. As a synchronous model, it is more friendly to parallel program since it is never blocked. As a result, we expect it is easier to reach the maximum bandwidth of the IO device. Asynchronous model sounds fantastic, but it is hard since programmer need to consider all dependency issue of instruction, which is executed in a synchronous manner.